Glad to see the sun after a week of rain. It's been good. I've got a couple of announcements I want to make you aware of this morning. This evening we'll be doing the Lord's Supper, so be in prayer for that, and I hope you'll come back and be a part of that with us. It's a special time. It's one of those things that we do because the Lord commanded us to, and we also do because it is to remind us of who He is and what He's done for us. And we also do it because it's a testimony to ourselves, to each other, to the world, about Christ, what Christ has done for us. So it is a big deal as we participate in that together. So that's what we'll be doing tonight. This coming Saturday, there'll be a luncheon. It's for seniors. It's a Valentine's Day luncheon. We're excited about that. If you're not a senior, you're welcome to come. So anyone that wants to come is welcome. The youth will be serving. It'll be from 11 to 1. So that's this coming Saturday. Who should, if someone's planning on coming, who should they let know? Is anyone willing?
Jana or Amy.
Jana or Amy. Okay. And if you don't let them know, you can still come. That's always just for a head count. But whoever wants to come, we'll be glad that you're there. Deacon's meeting will be next Sunday, and a business meeting will be the Wednesday after that, so just so you're keeping up with that. Two quick meetings. One of them, right after this morning's service, I'd like to have a quick meeting with anyone that would be interested in doing a trip or a retreat over spring break. Spring break is March 13th, the week of March 13th. So if you're going to be in town and you would like to do something like that, let me know. I've got a couple of different options that are possibilities, and I want to see what the interest is. And if there's not any interest, we won't do it. And if there is, then we will. So that'd be helpful to me. So let's just meet up front right after the service. Also, next Sunday morning, there's going to be a VBS meeting right after the service. So be aware of that. And then the other announcement I wanted to make this is just to continue to be praying for our revival services. For Paul and Adam and myself and Brady, as we're preparing these messages, we'll be talking about the seven last words of Christ, so seven sermons. As we walk through that, as we think again about who Jesus is and what He's done, pray that the Lord prepares our hearts and our hearts as a church, and also for the community around us, that we would be able to share with everyone the good news of Christ's love for us and His concern and His salvation that He brought to us. Are there any other announcements we need to make this morning? Okay. As we come to a time of prayer, let's remember there's several people that are going to be having medical procedures this week. So be in prayer for those, and be in prayer for this time of revival. Specifically, pray for people that you know, people you work with, or your family, or people that you live in your neighborhood, that you know they don't know Jesus, that the Lord would speak through them, to them, and that He would draw them to Himself. So let's spend some time this morning praying before we move forward in our worship. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we praise you for your love for us, that you saw us in our iniquity, in our sin, and you made a way when we couldn't come to you. You made a way that we could be with you by coming to us. We thank you for the example life that was led so that we would understand what righteousness looks like, that we would be able to see the image of the invisible God. We thank you for the death and the resurrection, that our sins would be paid for. And Heavenly Father, we praise you that we can gather with other believers. We are together a family connected by your sacrifice for us. And we pray, Lord, that we would worship you this morning with all of our hearts, that the words that we sing and the meditations of our heart, that they would be together glorifying to your name. They would bring you the praise and honor that you deserve. Help us to worship you well. Forgive us where we fail you. Thank you for your mercy that renews every day. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I'd like to invite you to come on up and get in the choir.
Bring it. Jesus. would come again someday. If back then it seemed so real, then I just can't help but feel how much closer his coming is today.
Thank you. All right, let's, as you find your seats, the ushers are forward here, and let's have prayer before we take up the offering. Thank you.
Amen.
Lamech have came.
And from the dust my life he raised.
Pass the promise to our sons and daughters, God Most High, God our Father, we bear witness.
He will guard the feet of faithful ones.
He will hold his faithful ones.
But the wicked, they will not prevail.
Not by might will man prevail.
He is coming soon to judge the earth.
He is coming soon to judge the earth.
For the Lord gives power to his king.
All strength to his anointed king.
Pass the promise to our sons and daughters, God Most High, God our Father, we bear witness. Pass the promise to our sons and daughters, God Most High, God our Father, we bear witness. Pass the promise to our sons and daughters, God Most High, God our Father, we bear witness. Pass the promise to our sons and daughters, God Most High, God our Father, we bear witness. We bear witness. We bear witness.
If you will, turn with me to Ephesians chapter 6. I was talking to a pastor recently, and almost always if I have friends who are pastors, we end up talking about what we're currently preaching and how we go about preparing sermons and just a lot of things that have to do with what we've been learning from what we've been studying and that sort of thing. And he was saying, and I very much relate to this, that he was saying that after many years of preaching, he's now kind of realized that any series longer than about 4 weeks is kind of hard to keep up with. And to be fair, if you were to really quiz me on the specifics of something from 10 weeks ago, you probably could get me. But that because I'm thinking about it all the time and because I'm walking through it, I have outlines on top of outlines. And so to say about what it is we're talking about this morning, well, on the one hand, this is our 32nd message in the book of Ephesians, in case anyone's keeping count. Apparently I am. And that we have understood that Ephesians comes in three parts. There's a section of it, if you'll go to the very first slide, there's a section that talks about how we are already seated in the heavenly places with Christ. We are seated with Him already. And it's our understanding that we have already been redeemed that we understand we are to walk with Him. And so the middle section of the book, which is what we've been talking about, is about how we walk before Him, not earning our salvation because we are already seated in the heavenly places. But because we love Him, we're going to walk in love and what it looks like. And so in one sense, we are in a series that's been on the book of Ephesians. In another sense, we're in a series that's been on the walking portion of the book. In another sense, for the last several weeks, we've been talking specifically about the family. We had 1 week we talked about wives. And we understood that what Scripture teaches us is wives, submit to your husbands. And what does that mean? How do you do that? What does that look like? And then we talked about husbands. Husband, love your wives as Christ loved the church. What does that mean? How do we do that? And then last week we looked at children and parents. Children, obey your parents. Fathers, do not provoke, but raise your children well. And so we've been talking about that. And now we really move to the last, if you will, on that sermon on the life of the home. And it's going to begin in a way that's really very uncomfortable for us in our modern world. So I'm going to read the scripture, and then I have a couple of comments that I think we probably should make before we look at what it's exactly telling us to do. All right, Ephesians chapter 6, starting in verse 5. Bondservants, obey your earthly masters with fear and trembling, with a sincere heart, as you would Christ, not by the way of eye service as people pleasers, but as bondservants of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart, rendering service with a good will as to the Lord and not to man, knowing that whatever good anyone does, this he will receive back from the Lord, whether he is a bondservant or free. Masters, do the same to them, and stop your threatening, knowing that he who is both their master and yours is in heaven, and that there is no partiality with him. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we are free in you. And now as we study your word, I pray that you would give ears to hear, minds to understand, that we would accept your word. Lord, if there's anything that I was planning to say that I should not say, I pray that you would keep it from being said, and that everything that would be done here would be pleasing in your sight. Speak through your word to us, Lord. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, the first thing I want to make a point of this morning is this idea of bondservants. Some of your translations might even say slaves. That's what the word is talking about. But our understanding of slavery today, it's interesting to watch how our culture has become absolutely and totally immoral in so many ways. To talk to students about why you shouldn't cheat in class, it is entirely about why you might get caught, and nothing about the fact that it's wrong to lie. And I could go on. We could talk about, I mean, there's so many ways in which our culture is broken. But one thing our culture recognizes as sin, it might be the sin that nationally we would all agree is wrong, is the sin of slavery. That is the one thing that you could really get in a lot of trouble if you were, and I'm not going to say that, so I don't want there to be this clip of you hearing me say that. I don't think slavery is okay. But if anyone ever talks about it in any way, that is the one thing that we absolutely all agree is morally wrong. And I was looking at some understanding of slavery as I was getting ready to say what I'm about to say, and it is amazing to me how in the United States especially, we really have come to this understanding that Christianity is pro-slavery, number one, and number two, that it's the Bible that supports slavery. And so before we even begin, I thought it would be helpful for me to make this point. And the point is that all cultures had slavery. You cannot find a culture around the world historically that did not have one person taking advantage of other people by enslaving them. It has happened everywhere. It is a universal principle. When white people first came to North America, the North American natives were already enslaving each other, and that was already happening. And that goes around the world. People in Europe enslaved each other. There is no place where slavery didn't happen. All cultures had slaves. But it was Christians who made the point to say that it was wrong. Go ahead, if you will. Go ahead. Okay, thank you. I couldn't remember the four of them to get them in order, so better make sure I can see them. What we read in the Old Testament, I recently, last year, I taught for 3 hours on slavery to college students on UT campus. And so I've spent a lot of time, I've read every passage in Scripture that refers to slavery that I'm aware of. And as I was doing that, one of the big things we see is that even at the very beginning, when the Jewish nation became a nation, Moses was already regulating slavery. And I'll go ahead and tell you, the biggest regulation is slaves are people too. That was an important point. In all of the Old Testament, you read that slaves are not to be treated as inhuman. They are people. And then, if you study the history of the world, you'll find that as nations became Christian, slavery decreased. In the Roman Empire, there were more slaves than there were free people. And it wasn't until Christianity became a fundamental part of the Roman Empire that slavery began to decrease. Now, did they stop it? No. Did they go fast enough? Looking at our standards, we say, well, they should have went a lot faster, a lot quicker. But I'm telling you that Christianity, wherever it goes, decreases slavery when it gets there. And you cannot, it's very hard to find anyone who was against slavery that didn't get to that point because of what they read in the New Testament and who Christ is. Now, I feel like I have to say all that because in this culture, what I'm about to say, some people could misinterpret and say, see, the Bible is pro-slavery. That is not true. It is not. And a careful reading of the New Testament will do for us what it has done for every other Christian who has carefully studied it. It will pull us to recognizing all people are people and all of us are equal in Christ. There is no hierarchy in Christ. So I feel like I needed to say that even before we discuss these verses so we don't get distracted. The other thing I wanted to make sure that we understood is that in a sense, all of us are servants. This word doulos is what the word is, and it definitely can be translated slave, and the best understanding are people who are in slavery that have no option. And in the Roman world, to the people that Paul was writing, that is definitely who he's talking to. He's talking to lifelong slaves that probably don't have a chance to become free. However, the word literally means someone who owes a debt. And so for us to understand this, in our day we would read this and we would say bondservants, and it tells us to do something, and everyone here would say, well, I'm not a bondservant, so I can, you don't really do this, but probably mentally you kind of cross this out. I do this. When I read about wives, I'm not a wife. That passage is, now I can understand some things from it, but its basic application is not to me. And what I want to encourage you this morning is I want you to think about this idea of owing a debt. There's a lot of ways that we can owe a debt. We can owe a financial debt. In some ways, many of us are in bondage to our homes. I mean, you need to do something? Well, you're going to have to wait because I owe the bank, and I have to work like I work so that I can pay my house on my house the way, and for all intents and purposes, you are owned by your house and not the other way around. Sometimes it's just monetary and other things, whether it's cars or credit cards. It is amazing to me to look at the United States. If there's one thing that we do well, it's apparently going in debt. And I get very concerned at how in debt our nation is, and we should be. But we also should not be surprised. The nation, the politicians in Washington are only doing what everyone in their homes are doing, which is buying stuff they can't afford and hoping to pay for it with some sort of future money that they don't have any idea how they're going to get. The government isn't acting any different than most homes. So again, it's not good, but should we be surprised? And it is a form of slavery. There are obligations, just things that we've promised to do. The whole understanding of being a bondservant is there is an oath that was taken that you're going to serve. Sometimes in the ancient times, it was done in war. When one nation conquered another nation, they lined them up and said, will you serve me? And if they say, okay, will you serve me? Yes, okay, you can swear that you'll serve me and we'll let you live is how you make slaves. And that's how it happened. And so the people that were enslaved had made an oath that they would be servants. We also have obligations. I'm supposed to teach a class tomorrow. The first class I'm supposed to teach is at 11:30. I have an obligation to be in that place. Those of you that have jobs, it's the same way. They've agreed to pay you, but in exchange, you have agreed to serve them. Now, I say all this so that when we read this, we don't immediately go, well, that was them and this is us and it's not connected to us. This is very much practical living life. Just like it was for everyone that's in a family, there is a husband and a wife and often children that we have to understand what does that family look like and how do we learn. In the same way, when he moved on from those categories, he now started talking about what does it look like in our work. And there were two basic types of people. There are those who are the serving, and there are those who are the served. Most of us are also masters. There's a reason when you go to a restaurant, the people that bring you your food are called servers. And because of that, they have an obligation to you to bring you your drink, for the food to be what you asked for, and all of those things that we recognize. And so when we get to the passage that talks about masters, again, don't look at this and say, well, I'm not in charge of anybody. That's not true. Most of us, if you have people that work for you, in that sense, you are serving as their master. You're giving them things that they're expected to do, and you're responsible for how they do them. That is a very similar relationship. Okay, so it's helpful for us to understand that. First off, that Christianity is absolutely and totally against slavery. And second, that in another sense, we are all servants. So it's helpful for us to understand that. So now, as we actually look at what the message to the bondservants is. And the message to the bondservants, it's interesting. There are several passages that talk about being servants. There's actually more of them talking about how slaves should serve their masters than there are masters how to treat their slaves. It's interesting that Paul seems to focus not on the master, but on the servant. That seems to be his focus. And we see that here. If you look at the verses, I think there's four verses that have to do with how the servant is to respond, and only one about how the master is to respond. So let's take a look. First off, servants, obey your masters. That is the overriding principle. Husbands, love your wives. Wives, submit to your husbands. Children, obey your parents. Fathers, raise your children. And now, servants, obey your masters. That's the command. And then he gives some descriptions. The first thing I think he's telling servants to do is to be humble, to obey your masters humbly. Look how he says this. Bondservants, obey your earthly masters with fear and trembling, with a sincere heart as you would Christ. Let me show you some other places in Scripture where that term, fear and trembling, occur. You don't have to turn there, but in Psalm chapter 2, verse 10, "Now therefore, O kings, be wise, be warned, O rulers of the earth. Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling. Kiss the Son, lest he be angry and you perish in the way, for his wrath is quickly kindled. Blessed are all who take refuge in him." This is a praise, this is a song of praise, and it is encouraging the rulers of this world to tremble and fear before the Lord. And it's a sign of humbly accepting his lordship over their kingship. That's what they're being called to do. Mark chapter 5, verse 33, we find out a woman who had had a problem. She had been suffering greatly because of a bleeding issue, and she snuck up and she touched Jesus. And because she touched Jesus in faith, she was healed. And if you remember the story, Jesus immediately turned around and he said, "Who touched me?" And his disciples said, "Well, there's a big crowd of people. We've all been touching you." And Jesus said, "No, I felt power go out from me. Who was it that was just healed?" And then we read, "But the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling." There it is again. "And fell down before him and told him the whole truth. And he said to her, 'Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease.'" Her faith was that Jesus could heal her. And Jesus helped her to understand that that's exactly what happened. And there was a making sure that we had the relationship correctly. It wasn't a magic garment. It wasn't a magic touch. But the creator of the universe, who knew her, stepped out of heaven, and although she touched him, it was him that touched her to heal her. And he's emphasizing that. And she realized that, and that's why she came with fear and trembling. Another place we see it, remember Paul and Silas were thrown into prison. While they were in prison, there was a great earthquake, and the doors of everything was opened, and they could have easily escaped. And the jailer, who understood that the penalty for letting prisoners escape was death, prepared to kill himself. He said, "I'd rather take my own life than to let them take my life." Acts chapter 16, when the jailer woke and saw the prison doors were open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself, supposing that the prisoners had escaped. But Paul cried out with a loud voice, "Do not harm yourself, for we are all here." And the jailer called for lights and rushed in, and trembling with fear, he fell down before Paul and Silas. That's a very interesting verse. Why was he trembling? Was it because he was afraid of death? No, he was just about to kill himself. Was he afraid of them? No, they were still in prison when they could have just walked away. It was because he recognized his own place before the Lord, and he recognized the love of Christ. We know that because it says, then he brought them out and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved, you and your household." And finally, one more place that we see it. Now we see it actually from the perspective of someone who is saved. Paul talking to the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians chapter 2. "When I came to you, brothers, I did not come proclaiming to you the testimony of God with lofty speech or wisdom. For I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. And I was with you in weakness and in fear and much trembling. And my speech and my message were not in plausible words of wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that your faith might not rest in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God." If you know anything about Paul's life, to think that he was afraid of people seems ridiculous. Paul was not a person afraid of people. He was willing to tell people hard things in dangerous places. That's the reason he was stoned and beat over and over again and thrown in prison, is because he was willing to share the good news of Christ even when people told him to quit. And so when it says that he was with them in weakness and much fear and trembling, it had nothing to do with him being afraid of them, but it was because he understood the greatness of the message he was proclaiming, and he understood his place in it. Now, I say all that so that when we read that the servants are being told you need to obey your masters with fear and trembling, it's not as if he's saying you need to shake in your boots because those are powerful people. He's saying, you need to be humble. Your attitude toward those who are over you should be one of humility. For those of us with jobs, this is a hard lesson. To treat our bosses with respect. And more importantly, to treat ourselves with humility. Secondly, not only humbly, but also from the heart. It's easy to do the right thing because you know people are watching. It's easy to do the right thing because you think you can get ahead by it. It is hard to do the right thing when you're doing it from the heart. And he specifically says, not so that other people can see it. Not by the way of eye service, as people pleasers. You're not doing it to please your master, and you're not doing it just so they can see you. You're doing it from the heart. You want to be a good employee? Try to understand what your boss or your company or wherever it is that you're working, try to understand what it is they're doing and try to make them succeed from the heart. You're not just punching a clock to put in your hours in. You're actually giving your all for what it is they're trying to do. And this can go all the way up for the very big things to the very small things. As to the Lord. So humbly from the heart, as to the Lord. Bondservants, obey your earthly masters with fear and trembling, with a sincere heart, as you would Christ. Not by the way of eye service or as people pleasers, but as bondservants of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart, rendering service with a good will as to the Lord, not as to man. Now, I've thought a lot about this. You know what it is about Christianity that destroys slavery? It's the recognition that all of us are already his slaves. And again, that's a tough thing to say, but when we come to Christ, what it means when you say, when you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, it's putting Him in His proper place, which is the King over my life, which means I am His servant. And so the message to those people who are serving earthly masters is, look, God has placed you where God has placed you. Submit to your earthly masters. Do what God is calling you to do there. But recognize as you're doing it, you're not doing it to them. You're doing it as service to me. This is not a great analogy, but maybe it would be helpful. There are very few people in this world that I would be, how do I say this? If Jana has a need, I will do almost anything to meet Jana's need. If you have a need, I'll do a lot of things, but not almost anything. You see what I mean? There's a difference between how I'm willing to serve you and how I'm willing to serve her. The object of my service matters. But then let me say it another way. When I serve you, and when I serve her, who I'm really serving is Christ. And Him, I'll do anything for, because He saved me from my sins. He made me free. Why would I not give Him everything that I have? And so the servant serves the master, not because the master is good. That's not the point at all. But because in serving the master, he is serving his real master, who is Christ. When I was in high school, I worked a lot in the summer doing landscaping. And you might think that throwing a shovel around is one of the lowest forms of work there is. And in a sense, there's all kinds of jokes about that, right? There's the joke of the man who's supervising people throwing sod, and he has to yell every once in a while, green side up, right, to make sure they put it right. On the other hand, any of you that have actually thrown sod or dug holes recognize that there's a way that you can do it with the minimum effort, that there's no brains in it at all, and it's awful. And then there's a way that you can do the best you possibly can. And I can remember as a boy watching someone who was good at digging, of all things, and recognizing they had a skill I didn't have, and wanting to be good at what they were doing. One time he'd take a shovel full and he'd throw it out there and it would land in a pile. It was as if you took the shovel and set it over there and pulled the scoop out, and he piled it, pile after pile after pile, and it would make a stack. Other times, just a little bit different flick of the wrist, and he was spreading it. And you didn't even have to rake it when he was done, because he had it all spread out. And I learned that I could do what I was doing to the Lord as the best of my possible ability, and I could be better at it and please Him. And so guess what? I love shoveling for 15 minutes. But you know what I mean? That it is something that we can take enjoyment in when we're doing it to the Lord with the best of our ability. Colossians chapter 3 says this, "Bondservants, obey in everything those who are your earthly masters, not by the way of eye service as people pleasers, but with sincerity of heart, fearing the Lord. Whatever you do, work heartily as for the Lord and not for men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance as your reward." You see the point? I'm working for an inheritance. And I'm going to serve my earthly masters to the best of my ability, because they're not the ones who give me the inheritance. It comes from God. You are serving the Lord Christ. For the wrongdoer will be paid back for the wrong he has done, and there is no partiality. Don't worry about trying to make it even on this world. In this world, time will come. 1 Timothy, Paul says in chapter 6, "Let all who are under a yoke as bondservants regard their own masters as worthy of all honor, so that the name of God and the teaching may not be reviled. Those who have believing masters must not be disrespectful on the ground that they are brothers. Rather, they must serve all the better, since those who benefit by their good service are believers and beloved. Teach and urge these things." And again, some people who think that the number one sin in the world is slavery, and it is an awful sin, but the number one sin in the world is not accepting, not believing who God is. That's the number one sin in the world. And people would look at this and say, see, why would there ever be such a thing as a believing master? And what happened here is Paul flips things on their head. He says, no, you don't understand. If your master is a believer, you have every reason, and don't you want your brother to do well? Serve him well. Think much of him. Give him the honor he deserves. Finally, Peter says it even stronger. Servants, be subject to your masters with all respect, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the unjust. For this is a gracious thing when, mindful of God, one endures sorrow while suffering unjustly. That's strong words. Not even when it's easy. We have to do it when it's tough. But Peter is connecting the suffering that a servant does under his master with the suffering that Christ has done. He says, God is allowing you to participate in what Christ did as well. It's a great privilege, although it's tough. And finally, one more, humbly from the heart as to the Lord, and then also for their good, doing good. Notice he says this in verse 8, knowing that whatever good anyone does, he will receive back from the Lord, whether he is a bondservant or free. So serve with a good will, receiving back from the Lord. God sees, God knows. Servants, your job is to do good. When you work, everyone here that has a job, that you're going to go to your job tomorrow or at least this week, your goal at work ought to be doing good as unto the Lord from the heart with humility. That's how you should be living your life. That's what it looks like to work in the world. And Paul tells Timothy, and by the way, people will respect who God is based off of your service. And by the way, there is an inheritance in heaven. By the way, even if you suffer unjustly, God is keeping score. He understands. And you will be rewarded. That's what he told the servants. Now the masters, very interesting thing. And you notice what I'm doing here. In all of these statements, I am trying to pull from Scripture. So when it says, servants obey, that is a literal quote. And so when I came to do that for the masters, I was a little surprised. It sent me down a deep rabbit trail. Because what it tells us, if you read this, it says, masters, do the same to them. Well, what's the same? Surely masters aren't supposed to be obeying the servants. That's not how that works. That's not what he's talking about. But as I thought about it, and as you understand the reason why, what's going on is the masters are also being taught something about what it means for Jesus to be their Lord. Do the same to them, whatever that is, we'll look at that, and stop your threatening, knowing that he is both their master and yours is in heaven, and there is no partiality with him. The message to the masters is, do not forget, God is your master. So those of you who have authority over others, your goal should be their good. Your goal should be not service into them as in asking them what they want you to do, but in serving them in the same way that a husband loving his wife is serving his wife. And a wife submitting to her husband is also serving her husband. There is this mutual submission to each other that occurs, or mutual service to each other that occurs. So the master should be serving the servant, doing good, mastering, if you will, as unto the Lord instead of as unto men. God is your master. God shows no partiality. That's the next thing. That statement broke the back of the understanding of what slavery is. Because the whole point of a system of slavery says there are certain people and then there are certain people. There are the masters and there are the servants. There are those of good caste and those are bad caste, those that have the correct race and those that have the incorrect race, those who are rich and those who are poor, and on, any division you want to make, it is always done. It's not as if there's two categories like this. There is always two categories like this, one who is greater and one who is less. And the statement that Paul makes in multiple places is, masters, don't forget. Servants, don't forget. There is no partiality with God. You have it wrong. There are certain people, and there are certain people. And in God's sight, there is no partiality. So guess what? A man who became a Christian that had slaves, who really and truly began to follow the Lord, began to understand that his slaves were people too, and that God loved them and died for them just like God loved him. And the longer that went on, the more they said, you know what, this isn't okay. You don't need to be down here, you need to be up here. As we live in this world, and again, some of us here have authority over others, what do we need to do? What we need to do is we need to love each other, and we need to serve God. That's what it looks like. If you will, turn with me to Titus chapter 2. Titus chapter 2, verse 9. One more place that we see Paul speaking to bondservants. This is one of those passages. He doesn't even talk to the masters in this section. It's only to the bondservants. But there's something he says here that I think is important. Actually, and before I read that, I want to make a point first. In Philippians chapter 1, you don't have to turn there, but Paul introduces himself in the book as Paul and Timothy, servants, that's bondservants, that's doulos, that's the same word, servants of Jesus Christ. If you're here and you have accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you are his servant. In Christ, we are all servants. Now, Titus chapter 2, verse 9. Bondservants are to be submissive to their own masters in everything. They are to be well-pleasing, not argumentative, not pilfering, but showing all good faith, so that in everything they may adorn the doctrine of God our Savior. For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation for all people, training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in the present age, waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify for himself a people for his own possession who are zealous for good works. I want to leave you with the recognition that in Christ we are all servants, but also in Christ, we're all free. This passage to the bondservants is saying, look, do well to your earthly masters, but don't you forget, as you're doing well to them, you are adorning the doctrine of God. And you're doing so because you recognize that you have been redeemed. Colossians sets it up this way, that we were once in darkness, but now we're in light. We were captured, but now we're free. Yes, we are slaves of Christ. And because we are slaves in Christ, we are also free in Christ. It's a great thing that he took us as his servants so that he could set us free. If you're here this morning and you don't know what this means, I would encourage you, come talk to me. I'd love to share more. Or maybe you're here and you do know what this means, and you've decided that you want to rebel. The people who don't accept Christ, the reason they don't want to accept him is because they don't want to give up their autonomy. They want to remain free to themselves. First off, you're not free to yourself. You're free to your sins. You're bound by your sins. Having said that, if you want to be free, the way to freedom is to give your life to Him who can make you free. Freedom comes through service, through giving yourself to Him. So if you want to do that this morning, I would invite you to come. If there's any other decision you need to make this morning, we set aside this part of our service as a time of invitation, and we do it because we recognize that I hope none of these words are my words. Hopefully all I'm doing is pointing you back to Scripture, and that what you're understanding, and this is exactly what Scripture is saying. And Scripture calls on us to respond. So if there's any response you need to make this morning, you come. Let's stand and sing a hymn of invitation.
Number 316. From the sunshine of love wilt thou roam farther and farther away. Calling today, calling today, Jesus is calling His tenderly, calling today, Jesus is calling the weary to calling today, bring Him thy burden and thou shalt be blessed. He will not turn thee away. Calling today, calling today, Jesus is calling His tenderly, calling
Don't forget, right after the service, if you're interested in being part of a spring break trip, if you stay up here, you are not committed, okay? So don't feel like if you accidentally stayed up here, you have to come. But I do want to know who's interested and what that interest would be. I'm going to let Jana, I shared with her what I wanted to say so that I can go to the back door. So y'all don't have to wait for me to finish, to start. Y'all can go ahead and start as soon as the service is over. Are there any other announcements this morning? Don't forget the Lord's Supper tonight. All right. Well, let's be dismissed with singing The Family of God.
What did he say?
The Family of God.
Family of God.
Okay. Oh. Thank you. Would you like to share? No. Brady and Emily wanted me to announce that they're expecting. So. So congratulations. I'm glad that I'm allowed to not have it a secret. You see, my secret to keeping secrets is to forget as fast as possible. So anyway, y'all congratulate them. We're excited. So let's sing.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood, join heirs with Jesus as we travel this on. For I'm part of the family of God.